have your Bibles, please turn to Psalms 3. I'll try not to hold you too long today. I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard. And it reads this way. O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying to me, there is no help for you in God. But you, O Lord, are a shield around me, my glory and the one who lifts up my head. I cry aloud to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy hill. I lie down and sleep. I wake again, for the Lord sustains me. I'm not afraid of 10,000 of people who have set themselves against me all around. Rise up, O Lord. Deliver me, O my God, for you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. Deliverance belongs to the Lord. May your blessings be on your people. Let us pray. My Lord and my God, let me decrease and let your spirit increase and hide me behind the cross so that your words will come through to help me preach not so much a good sermon, but one that would do some good for the building and uplifting of your kingdom. My strength and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
In that fourth verse, the first part, it says, I cry aloud to the Lord. David called on the Lord. And this morning, I want to ask the theological question, who you going to call? Who you going to call? Now, some of y'all may remember back in 1984 that there was a song and a movie that had the same title, one of my favorite movies. And the lyrics start off and says, if there's something strange in the neighborhood, who are you going to call? If there's something weird and it don't look good, who are you going to call? Of course, everybody knows the response is Ghostbusters. Well, the premise of that song is that our problems are so big and our enemies are so huge that we can't deal with them by ordinary means. That we have to have some supernatural help when it comes to dealing with them. It may be godly help, it may not be godly help, but we need something to deal with our problems. And some of you may be able to relate to that. You may have reached a point in your life where you felt beaten up, discouraged. Good news and encouragement was hard to find. And it seemed that nobody was there. That's how David felt in this text. David had reigned for decades. He was the most powerful monarch the world had seen to that time. His military prowess was legendary. Remember, they said Saul killed his 1,000, but David killed his 10,000. But because of sin, David's life was falling apart. He knew that he had messed up with Bathsheba. And in this psalm, he is telling God, my life is falling apart, and I need some help. He was troubled. Because his son, his favorite son, Absalom, had become his number one enemy. But Absalom was not David's only enemy. David said, many are rising against me. Many are saying to me, there's no help for you in God. His own friends had turned against him. Everything he had done seemed to be for naught. This was the most traumatic and humiliating event in David's life. Everything he had worked for had unraveled. Maybe you know what I'm talking about. Many whom he thought were allies and friends had abandoned him and sided with his son. You know how it is. When you're young, you have a car, you got friends. No gas in the car, no friends. And they told him and said, David, not even God can help you. David was in a tight spot. Have you his body, which seemed that he was stuck in a vicious cycle of trouble, and it turned into discouragement, and that turned into more trouble, and that turned into more discouragement, and it just went on and on and on. And your friends were no help. They told him, oh, you don't need God. What kind of God would let you come down with cancer? What kind of God would allow you to go to prison? What kind of God would let you suffer? Why do you even go to church? If there's nobody there who's going to help you. A lot of times that's the kind of encouragement you get from your friends. Job got that same kind of encouragement from his wife. She said, why don't you just curse God and die? Maybe you felt like that. Maybe there's been a point in your life where you wanted to curse God. Maybe you reached a point where you felt there's no chance for me to ever do anything. So you were willing to take extraordinary steps to solve your own problem. You started making your own rules. Some of you may have sought out palm readers, root doctors, witches, rather than ask God for help. You quit trusting your family. You quit trusting your friends, and you quit trusting the church. You start listening to the world, and the world says, do whatever it takes, by any means necessary. Even your Christian friends said, God's not going to help you. Your enemies boast, God can't help you. And given a chance, your enemies would destroy you in a second. It seems that you can't count on anyone or anything. One minute your friends are on your side, the next minute they're against you. God seems to be acting too slow, and so you try to protect yourself the best way you can. People tell you to pray, but they have you believe that prayer is only for the weak mind. So who are you going to call? Evil seems to be everywhere. And help seems to be hard to find. You look around, drug dealers are taking over the neighborhoods and the streets. Home invasions are increasing. Gangs are increasing in numbers and violence. Innocent people are being killed by drive-by shooting. Something has to be done. People are afraid to come out of their own homes. Life has become miserable for everyone. And you call on God, and it doesn't seem to be doing anything. People are in despair. They go from one crisis to another. Some even commit suicide. Some drink or use drugs just to keep their sanity or help them deal with their problems. How long is this going to go on? How long is God going to allow your enemies to bother you? It seems that God doesn't care that you're miserable. And when you're in that kind of mind, you start believing maybe the world is right when it says that God is no help. Trouble is everywhere, and God isn't listening. Who are you going to call? But I'm here to tell you that no matter how bad things may get, there is someone you can call. And that someone is Jesus. His specialty is helping those whose lives are falling apart. Jesus. See, not many of us have gone through the trauma that David went through. But in some ways, we've had time where we could identify with David. Maybe you got fired from work. Boss called you in. Said, somebody said you did this and that. And now you're out of work. Prospect to find a job looks bleak. You don't know how you're going to provide for your family. Your life seems to be falling apart. But the only thing you need to remember is God is still working in the lives of his believers. Woo! That's why Job didn't cuss God and die. David never considered cussing God. Instead, he made a confession. In verses 3 and 4, he said, but you, O Lord, are a shield around me. My glory and the one who lifts up my head. I cry aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. David's heart was changed from discouragement and dejection to confidence and renewed faith. And in this confession David made, he had four important truths. One is when no one would help him, God helped him.
Amen.
Second thing, David had nothing to treasure, but God became his glory. God meant more to David than all the riches in David's earthly kingdom. God's love for David was priceless. David was a man after God's own heart. Third thing, David confessed that when there's no one to encourage me, God encouraged me. And the fourth thing he said, when he cried out, God heard him from heaven. So when you feel beaten up by your enemies, cry out to Jesus. James 4:10 says, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Jesus will take hold of your head and lift it up so that you can rejoice in his victory. See, when David was running, he knew, he understood that his trouble resulted from the sin of adultery and murder. David had secured Bathsheba's husband to death so he could take her for his wife. And the prophet Nathan told David, said, out of your own household, I'm going to begin calamity upon you. Beside your very eyes, I will take your wife and give them to the one who is close to you. And he will lie with your wives in broad daylight. God kept his promise. And you need to know that God keeps his promises. But God also keeps his threats. David knew the soil was going to remain in his home, but he knew that he could call upon God in times of trouble. There's going to be times when you feel outnumbered, and your situation will seem helpless and hopeless. It is in those times that you find comfort in reading God's word, especially reading the Psalm, and especially praying. See, the Psalms have a way of helping you become God-centered instead of just complaining about your troubles. Now, there are times when it's appropriate to complain. See, complaining allows you to cry out to God from your distress, from your pain, and from your sorrow. And people say, oh, you can't fuss at God. No, that's not true. You already got it in your mind. When you tell God, God starts talking to you. Then you have a two-way conversation, and God will change you. See, when you lament or complain and you plead for deliverance, at the same time what you are saying is, I know God's going to help me. You're saying, I got assurance that deliverance will come. And also when you're lamenting, you're praising and giving thanks to God for all your blessings. David lamented and called on God, and you can call on that same God. He doesn't change. When you hit bottom and can't go on, God will show up and give you an upward look, even when you're unable to look up yourself. Being a Christian won't make you immune to trouble. But because you're a Christian, God will show up in your time of trouble. And God knows all the details of your life. But David still told God, here's what's happening to me. He was not informing God, but he was just laying his burdens on the Lord. That's what we say, put your burdens at the altar, and Jesus will take it. David was acknowledging to God that I can't handle my situation. He humbled himself before the Lord. And you ought to do the same thing. Because when you humble yourself before the Lord, you realize that the only thing that's going to save you is grace. No matter what you are at, no matter what kind of difficult circumstances you find yourself in, even if they're the result of your own sin or failure, you can still ask God for grace. And God will grant it. When life was falling apart, David prayed. When you're at your wit's end, and when you're feeling discouraged, and when you're surrounded by evil, or just feeling defeated, pray. Don't allow anything or anyone to stand between you and God. Prayer is a language of people who are in trouble and know it. Prayer is a language of people who believe God will get them out of trouble. You can appeal to God and know that he will move you from hurt to joy. Trust God and know in times of trouble who you want to call. So what can you expect when you call? I'm glad you asked me that, Calvin. You can expect God to get involved. And there are three things you need to know. One, you need to know that God's going to answer you. He may not come when you want him, but he'll be there on time. And God will answer in the manner he sees fit. Too often we want to put God in a box and tell him what to do and how to do it. God's going to do it his way, and he's going to do it on his schedule. See, David waited for God to answer. He didn't just stare at the ground and say, oh, you know, I messed up and did that. He allowed God to lift his head. See, the head was viewed as the seat of life. And lifting up a person's head showed favor on the part of the lifter. In other words, when God lifted David's head, David had the favor of God. And God will lift your head in the midst of your rejection and dejection because you have his favor. David was trying to say to God, look, I know I didn't deserve it, but you have really helped me. God restored David's rights by lifting his head, and David humbly allowed God to lift his head. Sometimes we want to lift our own heads, and that's pride. Pride will destroy it. What God was really doing was showing the nation of Israel, I'm restoring David's reputation. He had been humiliated, but he knew he was God's creation. He knew, just like you and I, we were made in God's image. And he knew that we were a reflection of God's glory. And David knew that God's glory would protect him and it would bless him. David trusted God to restore his honor and to protect him. And when you feel weak and incapable of going on, or if you feel schemes or trying to take you down, who are you going to call? You call God and allow him to use those who schemed against you to move you closer to him. It's hard sometimes to imagine how David must have felt. If you read his family situation, he had sinned, and he was experiencing the results of that sin. But he wasn't the only one suffering. He had humiliated the entire nation. And David realized he had to leave because he had too many enemies. So while he was running, he called out to God in prayer. And he went into the wilderness, and he went down to sleep. He was able to refresh himself. And he was able to contemplate his situation. How did I get into this mess? He began praying to God. And he addressed God by his covenant name, Yahweh. David was hoping that God would show him some mercy. David knew that he couldn't just approach God and ask for mercy out of his own righteousness. So he placed his confidence in God's promises. And that's what we have to do. See, David said, if the Lord restored him, he would worship. If the Lord didn't restore him, he was still going to bow down and worship the Lord. But God heard David, and God answered his appeal for help. And you and I have the same help available. Just keep on praying and waiting for God. If you only pray when you're in trouble, guess what? You will always be praying because you will always be in trouble. Prayer is the language of people who know their lives and future depends on God's help. Even your silent prayers are heard by God. A lot of times we think we have to pray real loud, have to pray real long. You don't need to do that. In the midst of your distress, your silent cries are louder and stronger than the cries of your enemies. God can hear you. You can rejoice in a prayer hearing God who answers prayer. You should be troubled. You should be swayed when your enemies mock you or say that God won't answer your prayer. You should be fearful. Have the confidence that God will answer your prayer. Your enemies are only revolutionaries in God's kingdom and who are duped into acting on their own impulses. But in reality, God is using them to carry out his plans. What they mean for evil, God means for good. David was in trouble, so he called on God to answer his prayer for help. When you're in trouble and you need immediate answers, who are you going to call? Jesus. Second thing you need to know, God will protect you. Yes. Now, we have the saying that God will help those who help themselves. Y'all heard that? Yes. God really helps those who can't help themselves. See, God protection is all encompassing. He protected David by surrounding him and becoming his shield. Yes. And the word shield is symbolic for God's protection for individuals and for nations. It meant that God was your protector and your defender. He will shield you from the enemy's attacks. And David made it personal by saying, "The Lord is a shield about me." Your faith in God and faith in Jesus must be personal. Yes. The fact that David referred to God by his covenant name meant that David knew God would be his shield. David could be confident and not fear for his life. That don't mean you won't die, but you don't have to fear. God didn't give you a mind to fear. God is the only defense you and I need. God will deflect trouble from you and protect you at a moment's notice. All you have to do is call. His shield will surround you from above, from behind, front, side, and beneath. While your enemies are trying to kill you, you can be sure God's protection is stronger than your enemy's threats. How do I know God's protections will ward off the storms, the trials, and tribulation in your life by speaking peace to them? You know the story when they were on the boat. They said, "Lord, don't you care about us? We about to die." And Jesus said, "Peace, be still." Mm. And they said, "What kind of man is this that the wind and seas obey?" That's the kind of God we serve. Even if your deliverance is in the future, you can be confident God will respond to your cry. God is the defense for the defenseless. He's the lifter of the dejected and downcast, and he's the glory of the despised. That's the reason you can pray and praise God in the midst of your troubles, because he promises to deliver you. And when you're rescued, know that it came from God, grace and God's mercy, and not your own effort. Sometimes we think, "Oh yeah, man, I got out of there." And then you wonder why you're right back in something. No, if God got you out, when you get the big head, God said, "I'm going to show you something." All right. You need to remember your failures will not be your last word. Jesus. Your problems will not be your last word. And your loneliness and your guilt will not be your last word. Shame will not be your last word. Because God's going to wipe all that away. When circumstances have your head spinning, God will make a way for you and will rescue you. So when trouble comes, who are you going to call? When you live your life in God's presence, you can sleep at night without worry. Amen. That's what happened to David. When he fled from Absalom, he slept and trusted God to sustain him through the night. When he awoke, he had a new confidence. Why? Because God had protected him, and God will protect you in the same way. When you're in danger, God doesn't want you to be fearful. He wants you to trust him. You will sleep well and know that things will look better in the morning. You can sleep the sleep of presumption that God will deliver you. You can sleep the sleep of confidence that God will close your eyes and let you sleep with your head on his bosom. You can sleep and know that you're going to wake up safe. Don't be afraid, even if 10,000 people are against you. Just look them in the face. And if you can't escape, you can dash through your enemies in God's name. You just say, "In Jesus' name, I'm leaving." If you have to remain in the midst of your enemies, they won't be able to hurt you, because you were prayed up before you even went into battle. God will confound your enemy and smash them. All he has to do is stand up, and you will be saved. God will break your enemy's jaw, text in the cheek, and they won't be able to hurt you. Why the jaw or cheek? That's a metaphor that indicates biting words, distraction, and injuries. In other words, people try to kill you with their mouth. They try to kill your reputation. They try to do all that. God will break their jaw, and he'll deliver a crushing blow that will destroy your enemies. So when David had no solution for his problem, he called on God to protect him. And when you need protection, who are you going to call? Finally, you need to know that God will bless you. David repeated the covenant name of God because he knew blessings originated from God. David was actually telling God, "You are the only source of blessings." David wanted God to bless him in battle. The healing was done. And ultimately, God answered his prayer. Absalom was defeated, And once again, David was king on the throne. The only area David had any influence in is the same area you and I have influence in, and that's prayer. David's prayer affected God's decision. God blessed David. God protected David. God saved David. Yes. God will do the same for you. And when God blesses you, bless your enemies. Because when you bless your enemies, God will take you into his eternal presence. God's blessing demonstrates the height, breadth, and depth of his love for you. When your enemies see God blessing you, guess what? They might just turn to God. Along with your blessings, count your weaknesses, your hardships, your burden, your trials, and don't complain. It's in those difficult times that you discover the sufficiency of God's grace. God chose you, God called you, and God saved you by grace. Grace is for the worthless. God's grace, grace is God's way of giving you and me what we don't deserve. God in his mercy blesses you because mercy is for the helpless. Mercy is God's way of withholding from you and me what we deserve. And we get God's peace. Peace is God's assurance that whatever happens will work out for his glory. Yes. God blesses you before you can even comprehend his blessings. You are blessed even when you're being cursed and bruised by your enemies. You are blessed in Christ, through Christ, and with Christ. But don't become so accustomed to his blessings that you take them for granted. You should thank him for all his blessings. You should thank him for his grace, his mercy, and his gift of salvation. So when you get in trouble, pay little attention to discouragement as possible. Plow ahead like a steamer, whether the road is smooth or rough, whether it's sunshine or rain. You'll have your share of discouragement, but so has many others. Y'all remember Fred Astaire? Some of you almost may not. He had a screen test in 1933. And a memo from the director says, can't act, slightly bald, can dance a little. And he kept that memo over his fireplace. Somebody once said of Vince Lombardi, he possesses minimal football knowledge and lacks motivation. Won 3 Super Bowls. Louisa May Alcott, author of Little Women, was advised by her own family to work as a servant or seamstress. Beethoven handled his violin so awkwardly, and he preferred playing his own music that they said he is hopeless as a composer. And we know that's not true. So when trials and tribulations come, remain faithful. Yes. Don't be afraid of what may come. Know who you're going to call. Right. So if something strange in the neighborhood, who you going to call? If something weird and don't look good, who you going to call? I've heard some people call Muhammad. I've heard some people call Buddha. I've heard some call Confucius. Some of them call Daddy Grace. Some call Father Divine. Some of them they call Louis Farrakhan. Somebody may call Reverend Knight. And some may even call T.D. Jakes. Some of you may call Miss Cleo. Some of you may call Reverend Roosevelt. And some of you may even call Ghostbusters. But I'm going to tell you who I'm going to call. I'm going to call on a name, that the only name that you can call on in this world that can help. I'm going to call on the only name that is above every other name. I'm going to call on a name that every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess. I'm going to call on Jesus. See, you can always call on Jesus. Jesus will lead you through whatever trouble you come. He won't leave you abandoned. He'll guide you through your storms, your trials. He'll help you no matter what happens. He will cleanse you when you're dirty. He'll give you rest when you're tired. He will strengthen you when you're weak. He'll be your shield. In fact, he'll just be good to you. He'll be faithful to you, and he'll be your all in all, and he'll help you. Why do I, how do I know? Because he came down through 42 generations to help. He died and was resurrected with all power in his hand so that he can help you and me. He's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And right now, he's at the right hand of God interceding for you and I. He is still in the saving business. So when trouble comes, who are you going to call? I'm going to call J-E-S-U-S. Jesus. The Lion of Judah. The Lily of the Valley. Mary's little baby. So when trouble comes, who you going to call?
Praise God.